How many of you just love Jesus with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength? This series, Activate, we've said this, that we want to discover and boldly walk with love in these spiritual gifts. Discover and boldly walk with what?
Love.
Come on, say it again.
Love.
With love. With love. Love, love, love. I've rewritten this message literally 3-4 times this week. I've never spent so much time on in the Word studying this subject than I have really this week in preparation for this message. And it's changed so many times. I believe that the Lord just kept on giving me new and more revelation of even just how to approach this subject today. Before we dive into it, though, this is really my prayer for us this morning. I want to read this instead of reading our text that we've been reading to start off the series, found in 1 Corinthians 12. I want to read and start off with this, Ephesians chapter 3. Again, this is Paul's prayer for the church of Ephesus. And he prays this prayer because he wants, you can see it, because he wants unity amongst the Jews and the Gentiles. And it's a big work that's in store. But this is what he prays. He says, "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and on earth is named." This is his prayer now. "That he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love," say, "rooted and grounded in love." Now say this, "Lord, root me and ground me in love." One more time, "root me and ground me in love." He prays, "Lord, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, what is the length, what is the depth, and what is the height, to know the love of Christ, which surpasses all mere knowledge." To know the love of Christ, which surpasses all mere knowledge. One translation says mere knowledge, that's why I'm adding it. Surpasses all knowledge. It goes beyond just intellect. I don't know in this room if you can't sense the power and the presence of God even right now in this moment. Like, it goes beyond just intellect. It goes beyond just knowing. There's a knowing deep down in your spirit. And this is Paul's prayer that would go beyond just knowledge. "That you may be filled with all the fullness of God." Verse 20. "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that is at work in us. To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations." What I'm talking about this morning is the gift of tongues. What I want to do is I want to compare the gift of tongues or public tongues with private tongues or personal prayer language. I've entitled my message this morning this: why tongues? Question mark. Why tongues? Love. Why tongues? Love. I want to show you through Scripture why Paul addressed this subject to the church in Corinth. Because it's right between, he writes the spiritual gifts in chapter 12, then he writes of how these gifts are to be used in chapter 14. We're looking at chapter 12, chapter 14, but he puts it right in the middle, right in the middle of these two chapters, he puts the chapter of love, chapter 13. We'll be looking at that today. So why tongues? Love. Why the spiritual gifts? Love. Would you say love?
Love?
Lord, I pray right now for your love to be abounding, Jesus. Lord, I pray that your love would just flood this room. Lord, your love is here right now. But Lord, I pray for a greater measure right now in this moment. Let your love just abound fully. Lord, would you fill us up with your love above everything else, God? Lord, we are not seeking after the gifts, but we are seeking after the gift giver, Lord. For you have given us even a more excellent way. You've given us love. And so, Lord, may the gift of love be released. May it be released in this place today, Jesus. Lord, your perfect love cast out all fear. So fear be gone. Fear be gone in the name of Jesus. No fear, spirit of fear be gone, but only the Holy Spirit let it rule and reign in this place. And everyone said, amen, 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 amen. Thank you, Wesley. You know, one trap that we can easily fall into is making something that is very minor a very major issue. Think about it. If you're going to work in the morning and you get stuck in traffic for 15 minutes longer than you normally should, what sometimes happens to people is this. They sometimes let that one minor issue of being stuck in traffic in the morning become this really major issue in their life, and it ruins their entire day. Sometimes we live on social media, and social media is such a minor aspect of life, but for many people, social media consumes them. And it's, their life is dictated around how many likes, shares, comments they got on posts, and something minor becomes something major in their life. We live in a culture today where aren't we very easily offendable? We live in a culture today that is very easily offendable. Why? Because we make minor issues sometimes extremely major issues. I want to say this here this morning, that the gift of tongues, when you look at the totality of Scripture, is not a major issue. It is not a major issue. Let me also say this morning. If you speak in tongues, you're not any more spiritual than someone who doesn't speak in tongues. And if you don't speak in tongues, don't feel like you're less of a Christian because you don't, okay? Let's get that out of the way this morning. Don't make a minor issue a major issue. That's not the way, when you look at the totality of Scripture, what Paul is addressing here is because he's doing it out of love. Let's not make something minor something major. Here is the major issue in Scripture. John 3:16, y'all. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believed in him would not perish but have what? Everlasting life. The major issue in Scripture is this, that, man, Adam, he walked in the garden with God in the cool of the noonday. And he sinned and he fell away. And because his perfect God could no longer have relationship with humanity, he went and he sent his Son so that you and I could now have relationship with him and could go with him to all eternity. And so now what he wants is he wants this authentic, real relationship with his people that goes beyond just mere knowledge. And so the major issue in Scripture is this, that a God sent his one and only Son to this earth to be born and to die after a perfect life on a gruesome death of a cross so that you and I could have access to the Father and have relationship with him. The major issue in Scripture is not tongues. It's not the gift of the Spirit. The major issue is this, that Jesus loves us and he sent his Son so we could have relationship. That is the major issue. So let's not get hung up over minor things. But here is the thing, though, that tongues, these gifts of the Spirit, they are given to us for a reason. And they are to be stewarded by the church in a proper way. So you may be saying to yourself, Adam, why talk about this issue is such a minor issue? First reason I want to tell you why we're talking about this morning is because of love. Love. Because God is establishing his kingdom here on the earth. And he's given us this gift out of love because it is a weapon. for our warfare. You see, we are in a battle in the gift of tongues. This might be out there for some of you if you're new here to church this morning. And so talk to me afterwards. But the gift of tongues, it is a weapon of our warfare. I had a conversation with my dad this past week and we were talking about this subject. And he was like, Adam, it is the most powerful gift that I have in my life. I exercise it and it is a powerful weapon to be used against the enemy. Here's the second reason why we were talking about this subject. First reason was love, second reason is love. But for a different reason. Because if we walk in these gifts in a way that is not biblical, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, what it can do is so much damage to the body of Christ. And we don't want to abuse these gifts, we want to look at them in a proper, in a healthy way, amen? So we're approaching this subject with love. Paul's entire purpose of writing chapter 12 and chapter 14, where he tackles the gifts of the Spirit, and he tackles how to operate in these gifts, was his love for the church of Corinth. It was his love for them. So let's look at our text for today, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 12, 10. To another, different kinds of tongues. I want to teach on this now. To another, different kinds of tongues. I see the word tongues, I think we can all agree here, tongues as being plural, it's not singular. To another, different kinds of tongues. Kinds would be, there's more than one type of tongue. So the Bible clearly shows that there are two types of tongues. Let's look at this in Scripture. Here's the first kind of tongue. So number one today that I want to give you, number one, the Holy Spirit makes available a private tongue because of his love. He makes available a private tongue because of his love. So when talking about a private tongue, I want to just kind of preface this. I'll kind of use this interchangeably, private and personal prayer language, okay? So my language and how I talk, I might use, say, private tongue, I might say personal prayer language. 1 Corinthians 14, 2, he says this. He who speaks in a tongue... Notice this tongue here is singular, not plural. He who speaks in a tongue. Which tongue is he referring to here? He's referring to a personal prayer language. He who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands him, however in the Spirit he speaks what? Mysteries. A personal prayer language is not speaking to others, but only to God. Again, this is a personal prayer language. A personal prayer language. And it is something that you have control over and you initiate. Look at this, 1 Corinthians 14, 14 through 15. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is the conclusion then? I will pray. So Paul makes a choice, makes a couple of different statements here. I will. Paul makes a choice. I'm going to pray in my spirit. And I'm also going to pray in my normal language. So what is the conclusion? That I will pray with the Spirit. I will also pray with the understanding. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. Say, I will. Paul is saying, I will pray in the Spirit. I will pray with my understanding. Paul reveals how he uses tongues in his own personal life. Your personal prayer language is simply just praying with your spirit instead of with your intellect. It's getting beyond your intellect and allowing the Lord just to pray through you. And there's no suggestion here in Scripture of hysteria or emotionalism, anything like that. He's just simply making a choice in the moment here with his personal prayer language. I'm going to pray in my spirit. I'm also going to pray with my knowledge. You know, when I'm in my own individual prayer time in the mornings, I will go back and forth. I'll pray in English and I'll pray in the Spirit. I'll pray with my personal prayer language. It's a really beautiful exchange that I'm having between the Lord in that moment. It's really a beautiful thing that it's a weapon, as just I said earlier, that I'm using in that moment. And we'll read this in a moment, but it's edifying my spirit man. So I want to give you two different reasons why we pray in our personal prayer language. Here's the first reason for personal prayer language. It is intercession. It is for intercession. What's the definition of intercession? Intercession is this: the act of petitioning God or praying on behalf of another person or group. So the Spirit of God prays on our behalf for another group. Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us. I love that. The Spirit himself makes intercession with us for groanings which cannot be uttered. Now, he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of Christ is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So it's when you don't know what to pray and you just need the Spirit to pray for you, that's when you begin to use your personal prayer language as intercession. And what's crazy awesome about this, when you really think about it, if the Spirit is praying through you, the Spirit's going to be praying perfect prayers for you. So when you begin to intercede through your prayer language, you're literally praying perfect, the Holy Spirit is praying perfect prayers through you. Because he's praying them, you're not praying them. We don't pray perfect prayers, y'all. It's the Spirit of God that does. My son Caleb, when he was born, there were some complications with his birth. Don't take this any kind of way, but this is literally the medical term that I was told that he had. He had what was called wimpy white boy syndrome. For real, you can look it up. That is the term that he had. Wimpy white boy syndrome is when Caucasian boys have difficulty breathing when they're born. It's legit. Like, that's really what he had. Yes, what? I know exactly. It's weird. It's kind of rare, too. So he's born, and, you know, everything seems normal. Get to cut his umbilical cord, all that. It's a really joyous time when your son comes into the world. And Laura's holding him after about 30 seconds or 45 seconds of him being born. She looks down and she realizes Caleb is turning purple. He's not breathing. And she begins to just kind of freak out a little bit like any mother would. Oh my gosh, my son is not breathing. So the nurse grabs Caleb and she sets him down on a table. She's setting him down on the table, and she begins to, I'm just going to call this, I don't know what it's called, I couldn't remember what she said it was in the moment. She's going to put this apparatus together, and there's two different pieces, and you put it together, and she's going to put this thing over his nose and over his mouth so that he can breathe. And as she begins to put it together, one of the pieces drops out of her hands, and it rolls on the other side of the room, up underneath Laura's bed. And I'm thinking to myself, what is going on? And she goes over to try to find it, and she can't find it anywhere. And so I'm freaking out in that moment. Like, my son is laying there, and this is 30 seconds later. My son is laying there on the table, and he's literally purple and can't breathe. He hasn't taken a breath yet. And he's dying on the table, and she just dropped this thing that's going to unclog his lungs for him to be able to breathe again. And it goes across, and she can't find it anywhere. And so what do? I do the only thing sensible in that moment as a person who has their prayer language. I begin to pray and intercede for my son with my personal prayer language in that moment. I didn't know what to pray in that moment. I didn't know what to do. All I needed to do in that moment, because I was panicking, was begin to pace the room and begin to pray in the Holy Spirit. And I begin to pace the room and just begin to use my prayer language in that moment. And the nurse goes over there and she hits a button, and it's like this big red panic button. The next thing I know is like the room is turning red. Because there's all these different lights, bam, 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 you know what's going on. And so the other nurses come in, and the nurses are like, hey, where's this, I'll call it doodad, where's this apparatus, this doodad? And she's like, I don't know, I can't find it. So another nurse has common sense. She runs to the other room, she grabs whatever's in the other room, puts the apparatus together, and finally, this is the longest, probably 3 minutes of my entire life, y'all, finally puts it together, puts it on Caleb, and gets him to breathe. It was a crazy moment. A moment that I will never absolutely forget, but a moment where I'm so glad that I was able to use the Holy Spirit that lives inside of me to begin to pray through me and begin to intercede for my son on our behalf. So what's the first way that you can use your personal prayer language? It is for intercession. Here's a second way personal prayer language is used. It is used to build up your spirit. It's used to build up your spirit. Jude 1:20, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 14:4, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. I don't know about you, but there are moments in my life where I just need my flesh to be silent and my spirit to be made known. There are moments in my life where I'm like, man, I'm being bombarded by temptation. I don't need to listen to my flesh any longer. I just need to listen to the spirit. And what do? I begin to use my prayer language to edify my spirit and not my flesh. Inevitably, every time that I begin to about to bring the word here on Sunday morning, my prayer is, Lord, help me not to try to please man. My bar is just to please you. Lord, help me to love your people really well. But then inevitably, what I'll begin to pray is I'll just begin to use my personal prayer language to build my spirit up. Why? Because I know that without the Holy Spirit, my words, y'all, are just empty. They carry no weight whatsoever, and I have to have the help of the Holy Spirit in that moment. And so it's a way of just saying, Lord, I'm nothing, and you are everything. So Spirit of God, just begin to rise up within me. So what are we doing? We're edifying our spirit man and not listening to our flesh any longer. Here is the second kind of tongue. The first kind of tongue is a personal prayer language or a private tongue. The second kind of tongue, here's number two, the Holy Spirit makes available to his church a public tongue because of love. The Holy Spirit makes available to his church a public tongue because of love. I'll use public tongue interchangeably often with just the gift of tongues. And a public tongue, when used, must be done in what? In decency and in order. It has to be done. A public tongue must be done in decency and in order. 1 Corinthians 14:39 through 40. Therefore, brethren, desire earnestly to prophesy. And watch this. Do not forbid to speak with tongues. Don't forbid it. We are not to forbid speaking in tongues. It's very plain in scripture right there. Do not forbid speaking in tongues. Why? Because it is a weapon to be used for the church. Is a weapon against the enemy because we are in a war and it is a weapon that we can use. So do not forbid speaking in tongues because it is effective for the kingdom of God. Verse 40 though, let all things be done in decently and in order. There must be order, plain and simple. There must be order, but order does not mean don't use. Amen? Order does not mean don't use. Some people will say this text here, decency and order, means that we shouldn't even just walk in the spiritual gifts at all because it creates too many challenges within the church. I would say that is completely wrong. I mean, obviously the Lord has given us these spiritual gifts for the edification of his church. Let's walk in these gifts boldly. Let's not back down from them. So this decency and order does not mean don't use it. We said this in week one, that misuse and abuse does not equal disuse. Because we've seen people abuse these gifts, misuse these gifts, it doesn't mean that we should not use them because they are powerful in breaking down strongholds against the enemy. Here's the other thing though, with decency and order. We're gonna look at what decency and order looks like biblically here in the text. I'm gonna read it to you here in a moment. But decency and order, the definition of decency and order to us may be incredibly different than what it looks like to the Holy Spirit, y'all. The Holy Spirit's decency and order may look completely different than the way we see it. Just think about this for a moment. Jesus was born of a virgin. None of us in this room have a problem with that. But when you really think about it, that is crazy. Like, that's out there. But Jesus was born of a virgin. That's why it's so beautiful. It was a miraculous birth. Think about this. Ananias and Sapphira. What happened with them? They died because they lied about giving to the church. How about this one? This is out there. Demonic spirits invaded pigs and the pigs ran off the cliff. Like, there's some crazy things in Scripture, y'all, and that's just the New Testament. What about the Old Testament? You can look at the Old Testament, and I can find even some other weird things. My point is this, that decency and order may look completely different than the way we view them naturally in our own intellect and our own minds. Do you understand that? Decency and order may look different to the Holy Spirit. So we must never be critical or judge harshly, but lovingly search out all that God has for us. But we must also have discernment on what is the Lord and what is not. Let's look at this, 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Let's read about decency and order, what Scripture says about what decency and order really is. How to use a public tongue or the gift of tongues for the edification of the church. 1 Corinthians 14. 22 through 28. Therefore, tongues are a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. So it's a sign to unbelievers. Why? Because then they realize and understand that, wow, there is a supernatural God that moves. When they see the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit, an unbeliever is like, wow, that is incredible. I want what they have. Amen? But prophesying is not for unbelievers, but for those who believe. Therefore, if the whole church comes together in one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those who are uninformed or unbelievers, will they not say that you are out of your minds? We don't want to cause someone else to stumble. We don't want to cause someone else to question their faith, do we? So what is this? This is decency and order. We don't want unbelievers to question what's happening going on. But I believe the power of the Spirit is going to reveal what has happened. But verse 24, but if all prophesy and an unbeliever or an uninformed person comes in, he is convinced by all, he is convicted by all. Which is why Paul says, I'd rather you just all prophesy, because then they would understand what is happening going on. Verse 25, and thus the secrets of his heart are revealed. And so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is truly among you. Verse 26, how is it then, brethren, whenever you come together, each of you has a psalm, has a teaching, has a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation. Let all things be done for what? Come on, say it one more time. Paul is saying, let all things be done for the edification of the church. If anyone speaks in a tongue, here's some ground rules for it. If anyone speaks in a tongue, let there be two, or at the most, so two is ideal, or at the most, three, each in turn. Here's the next part. But if there is no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. So to sum up the reason for public tongues, to sum this all up, the reason for public tongues is this. It's a sign to the unbeliever. We read that in verse 22. And it's for the edification of all. We read that in verse 26. Now, what are the ground rules? How do we use this? What is decency and order according to Scripture? Decency and order is this. No more than three times in a service. We read that in verse 27. And there must be interpretation. Verse 27 and 28. All right. Everybody just take a deep breath. let me tell you a story. Back about 6 years ago, I was questioning in my spirit and in my heart whether or not this gift was for today, for different reasons. It was a battle inside of me because I've had different debates with different people and just talking about this subject that is obviously controversial within the church. And I was going through a season, a time where I was just wondering, Lord, is this for me? Is this for today? Because when I was 4 years old, that's when I this sounds crazy to some of you guys, but when I was 4 years old, I received my prayer language. I received my prayer language at the same time. My dad received his prayer language, and my sister received her prayer language, and my mom received her prayer language. We all as a family received it the same night. This was 6 months before my mom passed away. just 6 months before my mom passed away tragically from cancer. And what I believe, and I've kind of walked through my whole life, is knowing that the Lord gave me that gift early on as a young child out of his love for me to be able to walk through this painful time that my family was about to go into. And so I had really never known in my life a time where my personal prayer language wasn't something that I walked in and I used, because I had been using it since I was just a young kid. And so I went through this moment as a, 6 years ago, 32, I was about 32 years old, 31 years old, as an adult, where I was just second guessing this one individual gift. And well, at the same time I was second guessing it, I had just come to Journey, and for whatever reason, Pastor Eric assigned me this topic to preach on. And I was thinking to myself, I didn't say this to him, but I was thinking to myself, man, I'm kind of second guessing this whole thing. Why are you picking me to preach on this right now? Isn't the Lord funny? And he's so good. And so it was a Wednesday morning. I'd already written my message of what I knew, because I was raised in a church that stewarded these gifts, and I've known it all my entire life. I knew intellectually how to write a message around this, because I heard it talked about a good bit. And so my message was complete and written, and I knew it was, but in my heart of hearts, I was like, I don't really know if I believe this stuff. And so I was alone in my family was gone. It was a Wednesday morning. I was alone in my living room, and I just began to cry out to God, Lord, I have to know, is this real? Like, is this really me, or is it something I've just made up my entire life? I have to know. I need you to take away all of my questions right now. And so, Lord, out of your love, would you just begin to reveal this truth to me? I want to go beyond just intellect. I want to go with knowing deep down in my heart. And I just begin to cry out to God for 15 minutes. After about 15 minutes, I'm telling you, I have never felt in my own individual time the Holy Spirit quite like I had in that moment. And I literally, the Lord began to fill my mouth up, and I couldn't control my tongue. Like, I literally couldn't control it in that moment. It's only happened to me once or twice in my entire life. And this Holy Spirit just began to pray through me. And I was like, man, God, I just began to weep and to cry, because out of his love for me, he began to answer all of my questions, that because I needed to go beyond just experience, beyond just knowing, and I needed to know in my heart. And out of his love, he revealed the truth to me. It's the power of God in that moment revealing in his love for me. The Lord showed me because of his great love. The Bible says, if you seek me, you will find me, if you search for me with all of your heart. And all we're seeking after this morning is this. We're just seeking after his love, church. So why tongues? Love. Love. It's love. Love. I said earlier, chapter 12, the spiritual gifts, was written by Paul out of love for the church of Corinth. Chapter 14, and how the church should operate, was written by Paul out of love for the church of Corinth. Why? Because you can look very clearly in chapter 13. Chapter 13 is known as the love chapter. You can read it, and you can see it all throughout. You can see it in weddings. It's read almost every single Christian wedding. Chapter 13 is read. But it's not intended for weddings, y'all. It's intended on how to operate in these spiritual gifts. And it's known because this, in chapter 12 ends with this, that you would earnestly desire, if you earnestly seek after the greater gifts. And yet I show you a more excellent way. See, this is a prelude in chapter 12 to chapter 13. What is the more excellent way? It's love. It's love. The more excellent way is the gift of love that God wants to give his people. What happens is we make this minor issue of tongues this major issue when it's not. The major issue is, do we have love, and do we want to be filled up with love and all that God has for us? And if we just have this earnest desire, Lord, would you fill me with love, everything else will just fall into place. And so why does he say this? He writes chapter 13 out of love, and he says this. Let's just read the whole chapter together. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, but I have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. In other words, church, if you don't have love but you speak in tongues, just save your breath already. It's not worth it because you don't have love. Save your breath if you don't have love. I've seen the nastiest people operate and speak in tongues, but then they don't doing it with love. If you don't have love, just save your breath. You're just a clanging cymbal. We can't walk in these gifts with pride, with arrogance. No, it has to be rooted and grounded in what? In love. He goes on and he writes this, and though I have the gift of prophecy and all and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. I'm nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but I have not love, it profits me absolutely nothing. So church, you can prophesy, you can speak in tongues, you can have faith to move mountains, but if you have not love, if the Holy Spirit hasn't given you this gift of love, you literally have nothing. Here's the definition of love. Love suffers long and is kind. Love, it does not envy. Love does not parade itself around. I've ratted around. Does not parade itself, is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely, does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Love does not thinks no evil. Believe the best in people. Church, when we're approaching these gifts, don't have a critical spirit. Believe the best, because that's love. It thinks no evil. Verse 6, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails, but whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. You see, one day we won't need the gift of tongues. We won't need the gift of healing. We won't need the gift of faith. We won't need the gift of prophecy. Because Jesus has come back for his bride. The scripture is talking about when Jesus comes to establish his perfect kingdom here on the earth. One day we won't need any of these gifts, but I'll tell you what, right now we need these gifts operating and active within the church. We need them moving freely, and we need to operate in them in decency and order according to what the Bible says decency and order is, not our own definitions of it. We're not putting the Holy Spirit in the box, but he can do anything that he wishes and anything he wants. Now he compares it all to growing up. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face. Y'all, one day, I love that. I cannot wait. One day we're literally going to see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords face to face. Like, we're going to see Jesus one day face to face. And how we live our lives is going to matter in that moment. How we steward everything that God's given us is going to matter. We're going to meet with the one who has saved our souls when we didn't deserve it, when we never did anything to deserve it, and there's nothing we could ever do to deserve it. It's a free gift. We're going to meet with him, Jesus, face to face in our God. Now I know in part, but then I shall now know just as I also am known. And now abide faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is, the greatest of these is love. The greatest gift from God you can walk in is love, church. It's love. It's love. Lord, this morning, our hope and our desire is just one thing, Jesus. Let us walk in your love. Let us walk in your love.